Can a soldier's PTSD be cured by eating the flesh of the gods? Some scientists and activists think that might just be possible. We're not actually talking about divine cannibalism here, don't worry. It's all about magic. Magic mushrooms, that is. One of nature's most popular hallucinogens. These mysterious mushrooms have been the subject of fascination, debate, and thriving subcultures for decades. But are they a menace or medicine? Is the potential key to the secrets of the human mind just something people do at Coachella, or something far more sinister? Stick around and see, because today we're taking an in-depth look at what happens to your body and your mind on mushrooms. So what exactly are these special shrooms, and what about them is so supposedly magical? Well, it's not really magic, it's a little substance called psilocybin. There are over 100 species of psilocybin-containing mushrooms in the genus psilocybe, as well as several other genera of mushrooms that have been found to contain the substance. Psilocybe mushrooms are the most commonly used, however, so for the purpose of this video, we'll be sticking to those. These mushrooms are dark-spored, gilled, and tend to grow in tropical and subtropical climates, primarily Mexico, Canada, and the US. The majority of psilocybin mushroom species are found in subtropical humid forests. But that's enough mycology for now. We're here to talk about what these mushrooms actually do to the brains and the bodies of those who ingest them. So let's imagine that someone has eaten a psilocybin mushroom, and alongside that mushroom, they've swallowed a tiny little magic school bus style vehicle that we can pilot through their intestines and get a look at what's going on. Hold on tight and keep your arms and legs inside the vehicle at all times. Here we go. Wow, they really should floss better. Anyway, where'd that mushroom go? Right, down to the stomach, where it's being digested. Yawn, we all know how that part goes. But it's about to get exciting. See, the psilocybin they just ingested is headed to the liver, where it's about to be broken down into psilocin. Now, let's head up to the brain, where the real party is about to get started. That psilocin is binding to specific serotonin receptors, hitching a ride so they can speed down the neural highways. Now the brain is lighting up with activity as the psilocin begins to work its magic, particularly in the prefrontal cortex. This is the part of the brain responsible for abstract thinking, as well as mood and perception. Meanwhile, regions of the brain that don't usually communicate with each other start feeling really chatty, firing off wild signals that result in hallucinations. If we speed back out through the nose and take a look at our patient from the outside, we can see dilated pupils, a drowsy expression, and relaxed muscles. Wow, that's so embarrassing, they just dropped their phone! Can't really blame them though, psilocybin can also cause a lack of coordination. Nausea and vomiting are also on the table, but hopefully we won't be seeing any of that today. Let's head back on inside and take another look at the brain. More specifically, let's see what our patient is seeing and take a look through their eyes. Don't question it, we're operating on magic school bus logic here, and this person's on a mushroom trip. Their trip is just beginning to peak, a period of the experience that lasts for the first 3 to 4 hours after ingestion. It's getting trippy in every sense as visual and auditory hallucinations begin to set in, as well as an altered perception of time and space. Has it been 4 hours yet? No? It's been 10 minutes? Cool. Colors are beginning to look brighter, and images in our patient's view are shimmering and warping like the surface of the water, while some items appear to expand and contract as if they're breathing. All of the senses feel turned up to 11, and hearing certain sounds might trigger the sudden appearance of colors in a drug-induced bout of synesthesia. Thankfully, our patient prepared a comfortable environment, and they're in little danger of having a bad trip. All in all, it's a bit like a walking dream. And there's a reason for that. A 2014 study determined that psilocybin increases the type of brain activity seen during sleep. It's the same heightened activation of the emotional centers that occur when someone is dreaming. Well, let's leave our patient alone for now. Let's let them stare at that magic eye poster and listen to their classic rock. We aren't done learning about mushrooms just yet. Where exactly did these fun time fungi come from? They're naturally occurring, sure, but when did humans discover their unusual psychoactive properties? Psilocybin-rich, so-called magic mushrooms, have a long-storied and somewhat contentious history. Historians have traced the supposed use of these mushrooms as far back as the ancient Mayan and Aztec civilizations, pointing to statues and artistic representations of mushrooms found in Central American ruins as evidence. Additionally, there are records of Aztec people using a substance known as teonanacat, or flesh of the gods, which many of these same historians believe to be these same mushrooms. These mushrooms were used alongside other natural psychotropics, including peyote and morning glory seeds, to produce visions and induce a euphoric state in which one could potentially communicate with the gods. Spiritual practices involving these sacred mushrooms have been traced back 3,500 years in the areas from the Valley of Mexico to the rest of Central America, including Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador. The rituals were performed by the Huastec, Totonac, Mazatec, and the Mixtec people. Some examples of art depicting psychoactive mushrooms and plants include a sculpture of Xochipilli, the Aztec god of flowers, found on the volcano Popocatépetl, and the Tepantitla mural in Teotihuacan. The sculpture includes depictions of psilocybe as decorum native to the region, as well as tobacco, Hymea salicifolia, and the hallucinogenic Ololiuqui. The mural, which dates back to 500 CE, depicts the Toltec rain god Tlaloc, along with men who appear to be priests holding hallucinogenic mushrooms where the god's raindrops fall. These same mushrooms are also believed to have played a role in the coronation ceremonies of various Aztec emperors, including Tizoc, Ahuitzotl, and Moctezuma II. In the 16th century, Spanish Catholic missionaries who came to the Americas, including Spanish vicar Diego Duran, wrote about these fungi-assisted religious ceremonies. He wrote, "Wild mushrooms are spoken of, and they were eaten raw." Spanish friar Bernardino de Sahagún, who traveled to Mexico during the 16th century, described these mushrooms as well and elaborated on their effects. The little mushrooms that grow in this land are named Teonanacat. They grow beneath the hay in the fields and plains. They are round, and their stems are tall and round and slender. Their taste is unpleasant. They cause sore throat and drunkenness. They are used as medicine for fever and gout. No more than two or three should be eaten. Those who eat them see visions and feel fluttering of the heart. The visions they see are sometimes frightening and sometimes humorous. Those few who eat them in excess are driven to lust. Silly and naughty boys are told that they have eaten the nacat. In spite of the long history of magic mushrooms, they did not get mainstream attention in the United States until the 1950s. In 1955, an amateur mycologist and J.P. Morgan Bank vice president named Gordon Wasson became the first modern Westerner to experience and document a Mazatec psychedelic mushroom ceremony. His story was published in Life magazine in 1957 under the title Seeking the Magic Mushroom. He described his experiences with the ceremony, which he participated in with his friend Alan Richardson. By the way, Alan had promised his wife Mary before leaving for Mexico that he would never try these hallucinogenic mushrooms, but when faced with the opportunity, he chose to partake. He did experience a bit of regret, however, reportedly muttering to himself, "My God, what will Mary say?" just before eating his share. The mushrooms were provided by a mother-daughter pair of curanderas, or shamans, who gave each of the two Americans a cupful of six pears. Wasson ate them and detailed what happened next. They tasted bad, acrid with a rancid odor that repeated itself. Alan and I were determined to resist any effects they might have, to observe better the events of the night, but our resolve soon melted before the onslaught of the mushrooms. And what did that onslaught look like? Visions that lasted deep into the night until around 4 in the morning. Wasson said, "They were in vivid color, always harmonious. They began with art motifs, angular, such as might decorate carpets or textiles or wallpaper or the drawing board of an architect. Then they evolved into palaces with courts, arcades, gardens, resplendent places all laid over with semi-precious stones. Then I saw a mythological beast drawing a regal chariot. Later it was as though the walls of our house had dissolved and my spirit had flown forth and I was suspended in midair, viewing landscapes of mountains with camel caravans advancing slowly across the slopes, the mountains rising tier above tier to the very heavens." All in all, he witnessed 9 mushroom ceremonies. He also sampled the mushrooms outside of the ceremonial context, trying them with his wife and their 18-year-old daughter, Masha. And he wasn't done with them yet either. He gathered some of the mushrooms in Mexico and brought them back with him to New York, where he ate the dried specimens in his bedroom. He discovered that, if anything, they had gained in their hallucinogenic potency. One of those mushrooms, a sample of psilocybe mexicana, would serve as a primary specimen in the research of a scientist named Albert Hoffman, who would later be known as the father of LSD. A colleague of Wasson, Roger Heim, reached out to Hoffman and encouraged him to isolate and extract the psilocybin and psilocin from those mushrooms. This research was successfully completed in 1958, and by 1962, Hoffman and Franz Troxler had patented psilocybin synthesis. That Life magazine article of Wasson's attracted the attention of another famous name in the world of psychotropic drugs, Timothy Leary. After reading the article, he became interested in the mushrooms, and in 1960 began experimenting with them at Harvard University as part of the Harvard Psilocybin Project. The founding board of this project included Leary, as well as Frank Baron, Ralph Metzner, and Aldous Huxley. If that name sounds familiar, he was also the author of Brave New World. These experiments included the Concord Prison Experiment, which involved dosing inmates with psilocybin in an attempt to prevent them from reoffending in the future, and the Marsh Chapel Experiment, also known as the Good Friday Experiment. In the Marsh Chapel Experiment, a Harvard Divinity School graduate student working under Leary's supervision administered psilocybin to Boston area graduate divinity students. This was intended to test the potential for drug-induced religious states similar to those achieved in the traditional mushroom ceremonies, but with a much more explicitly Christian bent. The program ended in March 1962, when other professors at the Harvard Center for Research in Personality began to bring up concerns about the safety and academic merit of these experiments. But the new widespread fascination with these magic mushrooms was not going anywhere. But as the mushrooms and other psychedelics became more popular, the United States federal government began to crack down on them. In 1968, the possession of psychedelics was criminalized under the Staggers-Dodd Bill. In 1971, then-President Richard Nixon declared the War on Drugs and passed the Controlled Substances Act, which classified psilocybin as a Schedule I drug. The United Kingdom passed similar legislation around that same time. However, their newfound criminalization didn't stop mushroom enthusiasts from cultivating these mind-bending fungi at home. In the mid-1970s, psilocybin enthusiasts began to do just that, as the possession of spores and mushrooms themselves, rather than the isolated psilocybin and psilocin, remained legal in most states. Some enterprising amateur mycologists like Dennis McKenna, a hobbyist who would publish Psilocybin, Magic Mushroom Grower's Guide in 1976, after successfully growing some of the mushrooms in a mason jar at home. The ideal species for home growers was Psilocybe cubensis, and mason jars were the perfect place to grow them. This subculture of home mushroom growing quickly expanded to an underground network of advice and mail-order spore samples. In the 1990s, the art of magic mushroom cultivation was still being refined and redefined by enthusiasts. One man, a jazz musician named Robert McPherson, would fill a mason jar with grain, seal the jar's lid with tape, punch holes in the lid, and inject syringes filled with a liquid solution of spores into the jar. He adjusted this method, working to protect the sample inside the jar from contamination. After some finagling, he found that it worked. He didn't just stop there, but began selling these syringes of liquid spores by mail, along with instructions on the technique he had developed. In 1991, he began advertising this technique and service in the ads purchased in the back of High Times magazine. While McPherson was growing mushrooms, something else was growing: the early stages of the World Wide Web. The internet allowed a broader audience to discover McPherson and home mushroom cultivation as a whole. Just like the fruiting bodies they were growing at home, the community rapidly began to expand. In 1997, a teenager founded shroomery.net, an online forum dedicated to information on psychedelics, including the cultivation of psilocybin mushrooms. Other forums soon followed, such as mycotopia.net, and the community growth continued to snowball. The practices have evolved over the years as the internet and its users have grown and changed, but many of these forums are still active today. In recent years, there's been a movement to decriminalize psilocybin and psychedelic mushrooms, which has begun to see some success in the United States. In 2019, Denver, Colorado decriminalized the substance, followed by Oakland and Santa Cruz, California, in June 2019 and January 2020. In 2020, a ballot measure passed in Oregon that made it the first state to decriminalize psilocybin and legalize its supervised use. In June 2023, America's first ever licensed psilocybin service center opened in Eugene, Oregon, where it quickly accumulated a waitlist of over 3,000 potential patients. The fight for the legalization of psilocybin is primarily based on its potential therapeutic benefits. But what exactly are these posed therapeutic benefits of psilocybin? Though there is still much debate surrounding the efficacy of psilocybin, there is mounting evidence to suggest that it might provide a new potential treatment avenue for debilitating mental health conditions, such as treatment-resistant depression and PTSD. In 2022, a study was published in the New England Journal of Medicine, carried out by the London-based Compass Pathways, that suggested as much. CNBC reported on the subject. In the study, 233 patients who had previously tried at least two antidepressants with little success were given a dose of psilocybin. After taking the drug, they experienced a walking dreamlike state. They were then permitted to leave the clinic once they felt like themselves again. A 25 milligram dose of psilocybin, along with therapy, was shown to reduce depression levels after 3 weeks. In a King's College press release, senior clinical lecturer and consultant psychiatrist James Rucker spoke on the study, saying, "Our task is now to investigate psilocybin for treatment-resistant depression in larger trials with more participants, comparing it both to placebo and established treatments." Flaws in the research study were pointed out by other experts, however, such as Ravi Saad at the University College London Institute of Mental Health, who noted that there were not an equal number of severely depressed subjects in each dosage group of the experiment. This was not the only study of its kind, though. Clinical trials of psilocybin administered in one or two doses in a therapeutic setting have also shown a positive effect on treatment-resistant depression, leading the U.S. Food and Drug Administration to designate psilocybin treatment as a breakthrough therapy, which will allow additional research into the drug to be supported by the FDA. Compass Pathways described this as a significant milestone for psilocybin therapy and psilocybin research. According to CNN, neurologist Richard Isaacson of the Alzheimer Prevention Clinic in the Center for Brain Health at Florida Atlantic University agreed with the potential therapeutic applications of the drug. "The data are strong, from depression to PTSD to cluster headaches, which is one of the most painful conditions I'm aware of. I'm excited about the future of psychedelics because of the relatively good safety profile and because these agents can now be studied in rigorous double-blinded clinical trials. Then we can move from anecdotal reports of, 'I tripped on this and felt better,' to 'try this and you will be statistically significantly better.' But how exactly might a substance primarily associated with concerts and festivals in the desert work to treat these mental health conditions? Well, part of that magic might lie in the relationship between psilocybin and serotonin. It might increase the levels of serotonin available to brain cells, similar to how selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or SSRIs, work." Pharmacologist Brian Roth of the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill reported that scientists can see changes within 30 minutes to the connectivity of brain neurons. Others, like David Nutt, director of the Neuropsychopharmacology Unit in the Division of Brain Sciences at Imperial College London, have argued that the disorganization in the brain caused by psychedelics can disrupt the negative thought patterns caused by depression. In his words, "Critical thoughts are easier to control, and thinking is more flexible. That's why the drug is an effective treatment for depression." Nutt also described an increase in branching of neurons. "They can increase synapses. That's called neuroplasticity," he continued. "You shake up the brain, you see things in a more positive way, and then you lay down those positive circuits with the neuroplasticity. It's a double whammy. We can't talk about medical mushrooms without musing on microdosing. Say that 5 times fast." Microdosing refers to taking extremely small amounts of psilocybin mushrooms several times a week, something around 0.1 to 0.3 grams, as opposed to the 25 milligrams used to induce a proper trip. There have yet to be any studies suggesting that microdosing has the same potential benefits, and some attribute the anecdotal reports of positive experiences to the placebo effect. However, some scientists believe that it is still a subject worth studying. Of course, no mind-altering substance comes without risks. The use of psychedelics can, in some cases, be linked to psychotic episodes and the onset of schizophrenia, often assumed to be related to the stereotypical bad trip. This risk is higher in those with a family history of schizophrenia or any disorders associated with psychosis. For this reason, research into psilocybin tends to screen for and exclude those who might experience those adverse effects, such as those with a personal history of psychosis, mania, schizophrenia, and bipolar disorder. A bad trip can also trigger a sense of extreme anxiety or doom, one that can linger long after the trip itself has concluded. What exactly is the likelihood of long-term consequences from a bad trip? It's difficult to say. A 2017 study from Johns Hopkins University Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences attempted to measure the enduring positive and negative consequences of psilocybin in 1,993 individuals. They found that 39% of those surveyed said that their bad trip was one of the 5 most challenging experiences of their life, and 84% said they had experienced long-term benefits from their trip in spite of its difficulty. All in all, the jury is still out on the future of magic mushrooms as medicine. They may work for some, and they might be harmful for others. And another group might just like indulging in them every once in a while to better appreciate the musical stylings of fish. Only time and more research will tell what else will become of them in terms of legality or therapeutic applications. Now check out what happens to your body when smoking weed, or watch this instead.